Wow, it's been a while since I've had one of these. I think the last time I had one of these, I was attacked by somebody. Y'all may or may not remember that.
Remember the 5th of November.
So this is 5613 Working Street. This is where the address of the drug house where the individual... sorry. I get a little dyslexic sometimes. So what I wanted to talk about was the medical examiner's report. Because that's what the police chief and the mayor, Mike Rawlings, and the media is using to justify the shooting of James Harper. And so the initial reports that came out, they were saying that the James Harper, that he was armed, that they saw a gun in the house, and that during the foot chase, that there were shots fired at the police officers, right? Well, the facts have come out or have slowly been coming out since that day, and there were no shots fired by James Harper. James Harper did not have a weapon on him. He was unarmed. In fact, they didn't find any guns outside of the house, which basically just contradicts what the police chief, David Brown, and the mayor, Mike Rawlings, and the media were initially reporting. The second thing that they reported were that there were broken windows in the back of the house, or that they heard broken windows in the back of the house, and that's what prompted them to move around to the back of the house and engage in the foot chase. We came out here, the Brown Berets and the Black Panthers and DCOC, a few days ago, and we did an inspection of the property. There are no broken windows in the back. Now you can see all of the windows were boarded up. These windows weren't boarded up 3 or 4 days ago. In fact, they probably boarded them up in response to an article that DCOC put out on Twitter and Facebook, and then we sent out to the media. That's our assumption. We don't know if that's true or not. The third thing that they said, though, is that during the foot chase, that this individual jumped multiple fences. They said he jumped 3 different fences. We can't confirm that because there's no witnesses, right? And if there are any witnesses, they haven't come forward or made any public statements one way or the other. So when we inspected the property, you go back in there and look, there is a fence back there with another wooden fence and some trees and stuff like that.
A shack
back there. But you know what I'm saying? James Harper was 6'2", 280 pounds. That's a big man. You know what I'm saying? I'm not going to say that he couldn't get over that fence, but there are not 3 fences back there. There's 1 big fence and there's 2 side fences, right? And then when you move back into the property, back over there, it gets into that clearing. And if you remember from the police deploying the military into the streets, because that is what they are. They are the civilian military. They're the military for the police to keep all of us in line. It was all on the backside right over there, right? Well, there's not 3 fences between here and there. So that's the third contradiction. The fourth contradiction in the medical examiner's report said that he was a drug dealer, that he was violent, all of these things. He did have a criminal record. I'm not going to say that. But the medical examiner's report came back, and he didn't have any drugs, alcohol in his system. Or at least that's what they reported. So saying that he was on PCP or he was on cocaine or that he was drunk or any of that kind of stuff is a lie, and it's false reporting. So now we get to the real issue, right? And the question was whether or not James Harper was shot in the back. Because in Anaheim, a man by the name of Manuel Diaz was shot in the back by the Anaheim Police Department. And in Anaheim, they've been protesting for the last 10 or 11 days. There's been 30 or 40 people who've gone to jail fighting against police brutality and institutional racism in that city. So we stand with solidarity with them today.
Yeah.
So the question was he shot in the back of the head? Or was he shot in the back? Medical examiner report come back, confirm he was not shot in the back, right? But there's a small detail that you have to look at. Look at the report. Gunshot wound number 3 said, shot in the left elbow, back to front, slightly left to right. You think about that for a second, and what you'll imagine is the back to the officer, a bullet being fired, hitting him in the back of the elbow, right, his left elbow. So yeah, he wasn't shot in the back, but he was shot from the back, right? That means that he was moving away from the officer. That means he was moving away from the officer. That means he wasn't engaged in any type of physical violence when the officer, when he was shot back to front. The other two shots were from front to back, one close range at the chest. If you read the report, it said there was stippling. If you know anything about gunshot wounds, that only happens whenever it's close range. That was a close range shot, directly to the left side of his chest. He was shot a third time and went through his body. Right? So that's a contradiction. They're saying he wasn't shot in the back, but they're spinning it to say that because they want to avoid the fact that he was shot from the back as he was moving away from the officer, right? It's illegal to shoot a fleeing suspect unless they've already fired on you. Which we know didn't happen. The fifth contradiction with the story from the Dallas police and the mayor Mike Rawlings and forthcoming from the Internal Affairs Department is going to be the nature of the struggle between James Harper and police officer Brian Rowden. In the initial reports, they said that there were three fights. I'm guessing that after each fence was jumped, that there was a fight after that, right? Well, that's interesting because I'm having a hard time finding three fences between here and where the body was found. But let's think about that a little bit more in depth, right? Whenever Brian Rowden, the officer who shot James Harper, was asked if he needed any medical attention, he said no. He denied medical attention. And yet, he used the excuse that he was in fear of his life as justification to murder James Harper and shoot him from the back and then at close range in the chest. Fear for his life. Ask you this question, how can you be in fear for your life, have been in three fights with a pretty large man, and yet you didn't suffer any injuries, you didn't require any medical attention at all? The in fear for your life is a blanket statement that police departments all across the world use to justify the innocent murder of individuals. And that's what the police department used in this situation. Furthermore, if you read the police, the medical examiner's report, what you will see is that Brian Rowden had lacerations and contusions all over his face. His head, his eye, his ear was busted up. So that confirms that there was at least one confrontation between the police officer and James Harper. But from the medical examiner's report, it looks like James Harper got hit in the face a few times and he was busted up pretty bad. So again, that supports the contradiction of one guy, if he was alive today, would have required medical attention, maybe even surgery for his ear because of the blows that he sustained, but he's dead now. And yet, he was shot because the officer feared for his life. So that's the fifth contradiction. We organized this because we're tired of marching through downtown. We wanted to come into the communities, and we wanted to talk to the people directly. So I want to thank everybody for coming out. We've been passing out flyers about the Office of the Police Monitor. There's going to be a presentation tonight at the Pan-African Connection. I'm going to go more in depth about that then. Chairman Fred Hampton Jr. is going to be speaking, and hopefully all y'all will make it out.
I'd like to introduce a young sister here who'd like to say a few words. Her name is Liz Clinton from the UNT International Socialist Organization.
Hey everyone, my name, like you just said, is Liz. I'm out here today because, well, this sort of it, the murder of, and it was murder, the murder of James Harper is not an isolated incident. This sort of thing happens every day on the streets of America. The cops killing young people of color, the cops arresting young people of color, hurting them up, throwing them into jail by the millions, putting them on probation, parole. The cop as an institution is a terrorist institution that serves the state and the interest of the state, and it serves to repress and oppress communities of color and poor people in general. That's why you can open the newspaper on any day and read, well, no, you can't. You can't look in the mainstream media any day and see how many people of color the cops have killed on the streets in their own community. And that's a fucking outrage. It's an outrage that the cops can again and again get away with murdering people. So that's why I'm out here today, because it should not be tolerated. We cannot tolerate it as a community of people, the fact that cops are allowed to get away with murder. It is sanctioned. You can... The cops murder people on the streets, and the state murders people in the jails. We can talk about Troy Davis, who was an innocent man in Atlanta, who was locked up, had his life stolen from him, and was murdered in the state of Atlanta. You can talk about Trayvon Martin in the streets of Florida, who was gunned down by a vigilante. And this sort of thing is sanctioned by the state. George Zimmerman would not be facing anything if it were not for the fact that people came out in protest of the fact that this vigilante just gunned down a young man because his skin color was black. And I think that that's the point, is that the Dallas Police Department kills people of color all the time. In the last 7 months, 8 people have been murdered by the cops in the streets of Dallas. And we have to unite together and say that we will not tolerate this sort of treatment anymore as a people. That's it. Thanks. Thank you.
Bravo.
Oh, by the way,